Minutes before the president's impromptu news conference, shall we say, this morning, where he told repeated falsehoods about any number of subjects, the president appeared on a channel he has behind closed doors, according to the Washington Post, compared with North Korean state-run television. And there on that channel, the president continued to compliment North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un. And as CNN's Jeff Zeleny explains, the president even jokingly expressed a longing for a bit of the despot's power.
President Trump is closing his week just as he began it, showering Kim Jong-un with praise.
He's the head of a country, and I mean he's the strong head. Mm-hmm. Don't let anyone think anything different. Right. He speaks and his people sit up at attention. I want my people to do the right. same.
Only when asked today whether he really wished Americans would fall into line like North Koreans are forced to, the president insisted he wasn't serious.
I'm kidding. You don't understand.
But there is no mistaking the president's admiration for strongmen and dictators. He spent much of the week flattering Kim, almost never mentioning his heinous human rights record that includes starving and executing his own people. In an extraordinary exchange with reporters outside the White House today, the president made no apologies and said the end game was worth it.
Excuse me, because I don't want to see a nuclear weapon destroy you and your family. I want to have a good relationship with North Korea.
He also extended his adoration to Vladimir Putin. The White House is in the early stages of setting up a face-to-face summit with the Russian president, with all the trappings of a Singapore session this week with Kim.
I think it's better to have Russia in than to have Russia out, because just like North Korea, just like somebody else, it's much better if we get along with them than if we don't.
While Trump first met Putin last summer at the Group of 20 summit in Germany, a one-on-one meeting now would take on even more significance, with the Russia investigation still hanging over his White House. The president misstated again and again Russia's annexation of Crimea, blaming it on President Obama, not Putin.
Because Putin didn't respect President Obama. President Obama, not Trump. When it's my fault, I'll tell you.
Today, one of the most prominent members of his cabinet, Defense Secretary James Mattis, offered a different view of Putin in a speech to graduates of the Naval War College.
Putin seeks to shatter NATO. He aims to diminish the appeal of the Western democratic model and attempts to undermine America's moral authority.
So to undermine America's moral standing, Jake, very strong words, but important to note, the president has said nothing like that at all. At every opportunity asked about Vladimir Putin, he has never said those words, or rarely. We are hearing that there are discussions about a potential summit between the two as early as next month around the NATO meeting, but more likely, I'm told, in the fall. Certainly the president would like to have a meeting like that. But Jake, extraordinary words here from the president standing just behind me earlier today, saying those words about Kim Jong-un and, of course, Vladimir Putin. Jake.
All right, Jeff Zeleny at the White House for us. Thanks so much. My political panel joins me now. Scott Jennings, let me start with you. What's your take on the president talking about Kim Jong-un? He says he was just being facetious, sarcastic about wishing people would sit up for him the way that they do for Kim Jong-un. But he does keep praising Kim Jong-un and saying things about him being strong and tough when, you know, the reality is he's a murderous despot.
Yeah, I take the president at his word on the sarcasm, and I see the president's flattery of Kim Jong-un the way I see all of his treatment of everybody else. He sometimes flatters people. He sometimes savages people. We've seen him do that to his political opponents and other world leaders. And I think he just does it based on his feeling at the time about what do I have to do to extract the result that I want. I'm not sure if he ever really means any of it. I think he's trying to exact a result in a transaction. The fact is the North Koreans are brutal. They murder people in strange and crazy ways. They treat their people terribly. And I'm sure the president knows all that, but I'll tell you what else he knows. It's his job to protect the American people, to keep us out of a nuclear war, and to try to have peace, and to try to keep us from banging our head against the wall on this problem, which has been going on for decades. So I'm willing to give him some rope here if that's what the result is.
So Simone Sanders, let me ask you. I mean, the president, you heard him in that piece say he's trying to prevent people from dying in a nuclear war. The suggestion is, what's the big deal about some flattering words or looking the other way on human rights abuses that he can't do anything about anyway?
Well, because he's giving credence to them and giving them a platform on the world stage to make it seem as though it's normal. I really want to caution the fact that 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I did not think we were on the brink of nuclear war with North Korea. But when Donald Trump is tweeting, calling Kim Jong-un little rocket man, saying my button is bigger than yours, he escalated the situation that brought it to a point where North Korea could have attacked South Korea and then we would be in a war situation. And so Donald Trump, again, much like many things, brought this upon himself, brought us to a point where we were facing a nuclear face down with North Korea. And that is, I think he's trying to confuse people, but he did this.
David, I want to get your reaction to the president again claiming that the problem with North Korea is over. Take a listen.
You remember the sit-down with Barack Obama, I think he will admit this. He said the biggest problem that the United States has, and by far the most dangerous problem, and he said to me, that we've ever had because of nuclear, is North Korea. Now, that was shortly before I entered office. I have solved that problem.
I'm not sure that the problem is solved.
Clearly it isn't. And in fact, Donald Trump also said, I have people over there. He talked about the verification process, not very specifically, but acknowledged that one needs to take place. So even when he was having his conversation with the reporters today, Jake, he made clear he understood this wasn't the end of the road of the process. But in classic Trumpian fashion, he is sort of a master marketer in many ways, and he wants to repeat it as often as possible, even though it's not true, so that it becomes true in public perception. That is why he declares peace on earth. He has solved this problem, even though it's clearly still a pretty big threat.
The Washington Post reported more details today about the president's Singapore summit, including this stunning paragraph, quote, at one point after watching North Korean television, which is entirely state-run, the president talked about how positive the female North Korean news anchor was toward Kim, according to two people familiar with his remarks. The president joked that even the administration-friendly Fox News was not as lavish in its praise as the state TV anchor, one of the people added, and that maybe she should get a job on U.S. television instead. Scott Jennings, your response.
Well, I think the president was, I think the piece made it clear the president was joking about what he was seeing, but obviously he was interested in how the North Koreans were portraying the meeting versus how the U.S. media was portraying the meeting. And look, I think the president was rankled. I mean, it is true. Last summer, for many months, there were people who were very upset with the president for, they say, being too harsh on Kim. And now, after having this meeting, which, by the way, Americans support his policy of engagement, CNN's own polling bears that out, now they're saying, oh, you're being too nice to Kim. And so if you're the president, you probably are thinking, I can't win with some of these people. They won't take yes for an answer. So I think he was joking about the news coverage, but I do think he has some legit beefs with people who just can't seem to be happy with whatever he does, no matter the tactic.
Well, Scott, surely you acknowledge there's a difference between brink of war, rocket man, my button's bigger than your comments, and, you know, Kim Jong-un is strong and he's tough and he's a master negotiator. I mean, there is a middle ground where most presidents, in fact, every president except for Donald Trump, has resided.
Yeah, there is a middle ground where most presidents have resided, and most presidents have failed to move the ball on this issue. We have been banging our head against the wall. Look, I don't know if the president and his tactics are going to work here. I mean, we're at the beginning of a process that could fail. Kim could lie. They may never let us verify any of this, and that would be extremely unfortunate. But it strikes me that we have a little door open here. We have a little window open, and the president's trying to go through it in the way that he does things. Some people don't like it. Some people may think it's not appropriate, but we've got some sunshine where we had nothing, and I think most Americans are going to say, well, we're trying something different, and maybe that's the answer.
But do we have sunshine, Scott? See, that's the question. So, one, it's incorrect to assert that no other president could have sat down with Kim Jong-un. Many presidents could have, but what they did not want is what Donald Trump gave Kim Jong-un, which is the flags and the pomp of circumstance and the state-run TV ad that the Trump White House cut for them themselves. And so we don't know if we're in a sunshiny place. North Korea has agreed to nothing, and I think that's the criticism here. And for Donald Trump to be so upset about the coverage that he gets from the media, I think it just goes to show that he still doesn't understand that he is no longer on the TV side of things. He is now in the political arena. And as a spokesperson, as a former press secretary, there were days I didn't like what the media said. There were days I didn't like what CNN was saying about my candidate. But it is not their job to lavish praise on my candidate or principal. It is their job to report the news, and it's my job to beat back the lies. And Thankfully, the Trump White House doesn't do a good job at the latter.
Something else President Trump weighed in on today had to do with the Justice Department Inspector General report from yesterday about the Hillary Clinton email investigation. Let's play that.
It totally exonerates me. There was no collusion. There was no obstruction. And if you read the report, you'll see that.
I have read the report. It's not true. It does not address collusion. It does not address obstruction. It has nothing to do with the Russia investigation. It has nothing to do with anything President Trump or his campaign, what they have done. David Chalian, does it matter? Does it matter that he says this, even though it is patently false?
Of course it matters. The president should not say untrue things, and it's our responsibility, as you're doing, to call it out. Will it matter to his supporters? No, I would imagine most of Trump's supporters will hear him and say, oh, no, he got totally exonerated from that IG report. That did not happen. But again, he was going to repeat this so that he can make it so, not broadly, but so that there are no cracks in his line of support with the folks who are already with him.
It was about the Hillary Clinton email investigation. It had some tough things to say about Loretta Lynch, about James Comey, about Peter Strzok, Lisa Page, and others. It has nothing to do with the Russia investigation, nothing to do with potential obstruction of justice charges.
Nothing whatsoever. You know, Jake, I often wonder, and yeah, I wasn't alive back then, but if during Watergate, if there was Twitter, if there was a 24-hour cable news coverage, would the then President Nixon would have been able to make the case that Donald Trump is making now to his supporters? I wonder what the ability to speak so directly to people and to repeat lies time after time after time again has on the American electorate. The facts remain to be seen, but I think that's a key part.
Interesting. If Nixon had had Twitter and Fox, what might the world have looked like?